extraordinary lives, Royal Navy commander who laughed in the face of his most deadly enemy. Britain is full of unsung heroes and heroines who deserve recognition. Here, in our weekly obituary column, the moving and inspirational story of David Schutz, who died recently, as told by his mother Hazel Bagely. "My son David" by Hazel Bagley. When he was just 7 years old, my son David announced that he was going to be a Navy person. Not long afterwards, I took him to see That's Entertainment. And he decided he wanted to be Fred Astaire. He went to tap dancing lessons for a while, the only boy in the class, but ultimately the Royal Navy won. By the end of his 25-year naval career, he traveled the world, reached the rank of commander, and received an OB for leadership. I used to tease him that if he annoyed me, I would tell all his shipmates that he could tap dance, a talent he kept quiet about. We'd fall about laughing at that. He had a lovely sense of humor, even at the times in life when you'd think there was no humor to be found. David was diagnosed with stage 4 kidney cancer just a few days after his 50th birthday. Towards the end of his life, he developed a blood clot on his lung and had to take blood thinning medication every day. I remember him saying, "The doctor says I'll be on this for the rest of my life, so he's given me a 2-week supply." The cancer arrived at the worst time. He had retired from the Navy and joined a shipping company. He was also working as a regional director with the CBI. He and his wife Jo and stepson Zachary had moved into a farmhouse near Boston in Lincolnshire, acquired several rescue chickens and 2 large dogs. He was so happy. Then came this terrible news, yet from him there was no wallowing, no complaining. "It is what it is, Mum," he said. "We just have to get on with it. Life deals you a set of cards, and that's that." In fact, the cancer just propelled him to do so much. He started a blog about his cancer, which he called "The Monkey on His Back." He saw the cancer as his enemy, and set out to fight it. Some people shrink into themselves when they face something like this. David did the opposite. He was frustrated that he couldn't work, so he got a job invigilating at GCSE exams. Then, he volunteered to teach maths at a local college. With his qualifications, he was a chartered engineer, they snapped him up. David knew there were plenty like him, people with long-term health problems who could not get work but who still had a lot to offer, so he threw himself into helping them. With the help of a former shipmate who was working for a global internet company, he started a charity, Astrid, which was like a dating site, but matching potential employees with employers. It was so simple, but a brilliant idea. Nothing like that had been done before. Astrid recently won the race to become Recruiter's Charity of the Year. My older son Stephen is now the chairman, and is determined to carry on David's work. Even when time was running out, David kept pushing on. Many years before, when he and his first wife had lived in the Dordogne, he'd started a novel. Now, he dusted it down and finished it. A French Affair is typically David, full of humor and interesting characters. When the cancer charity Macmillan asked him to pose for their annual calendar, he said yes. He was only one of 2 men to agree. I have the calendar in front of me now. David is Mr. June, he's posing with a rugby ball. We didn't know when he agreed to do it that he wouldn't be here by June. It is a devastating thing to lose a child, and to watch David's decline was very difficult. He'd been such a big strapping chap, minus 6 feet 2 inches and very fit, but he became very frail towards the end. Not in spirit, though. He remained funny, clever, life-enhancing until the end. Yes, we were heartbroken to lose him, but we also had 53 years with him, for which we are so grateful. David's funeral is next Friday, and we are putting together a selection of photographs, from him in full military uniform to one of the Queen awarding him his OB. I have one of him as a little boy with blonde hair. That little boy went far, in so many ways. He made his mother incredibly proud. David Schutz, born May 11, 1965, died May 24, 2018, aged 53. Matchmaker Paula cured my broken heart. My wife Paula by Ben Smith. My wonderful wife of 50 years was christened Pauline, But from an early age she preferred Paula because Pauline was always the naughty girl in her childhood comics. And there was nothing badly behaved about Paula. She was quite simply the loveliest woman from the day I met her at a party in London in the mid-60s. I was a graphic designer at a firm which handled the advertising account for Bachelors Abroad, a company that was an early pioneer of singles holidays. It was where Paula worked at the time, helping to match make lonely hearts who booked holidays. Nothing made her happier than being invited to a wedding after a successful match. She obviously had a good instinct, because some years later she told me from the moment she saw me she knew Elle was the one. It took me a while longer, perhaps because I was recovering from my own broken heart after my first wife had left me for another man. Over the next 2 years, Paula put me back together and we married in November 1968, the start of a wonderful new chapter. Paul, my son from my first marriage, adored her and called her mum, and we had a son of our own, Lawrence. Paula never stopped smiling and had a wonderful sense of humor, evidenced by the nicknames she gave us all, among them Treasure Trousers, Tombstone Choppers, Snodgrass and Plume of the East. But she was also extremely clever. She'd studied history at University College London. In the mid-70s Elle became a cruise lecturer for Cunard, teaching art, but it wasn't long before my wife's talents were spotted. She was signed up to deliver lectures on medieval history, among many other subjects, to audiences of up to 800. Our work took us all over the world on luxurious cruise liners, sometimes for months at a time. What a life! We made so many friends, among them Morris Gibb of the Bee Gees, and the comedians Ronnie Corbett and Bernie Winters. Paula was lecturing until a year before she was cruelly claimed by cancer shortly before Christmas 2017. My heart is quite broken, but it helps to think of her as I like to remember her best, on deck, at sunset, a wine glass in hand and that wonderful smile on her face. Rest in peace, my dearest darling. And thank you, Paula Smith, born March 13, 1940, died December 16, 2017. Aged 77. Our age gap love proved skeptics wrong. My Wife Judy by David Box. Music and friends, those were the two cornerstones of Judy's world, and she'd filled her life with both since her early childhood. Naturally charismatic, she gravitated towards performing when she was a teenager and by her early 20s, just after World War II, she joined a prestigious touring repertory company. She later recalled how, after meeting him at a party, she'd been asked to audition by none other than Noel Coward. Alas, it didn't work out quite as she had hoped, after giving her boyfriend her handbag to hold while she performed in front of the master. He told her that she wasn't right for the part, but he was interested in casting the boy with the handbag. Judy's first husband, Leo, was an RAF boxing champion who she'd met when he picked her up after she'd slipped and fallen right in front of him on the platform at London's Victoria Station. They had two children, Riley and Barney, and Judy trained as teacher while she was raising them. She and Leo divorced in the early 70s. We met 3 years later in a local pub when she was 43 to my 26. Not that the gap made a jot of difference, not when I heard her magnetic laugh. We hit it off immediately, and when she asked me to move in with her a few months later I didn't hesitate. "She's only after your stereo," her daughter Ellie teased me. We married in 1975 and a lot of people said it wouldn't last. How wrong they were. While all around us the naysayers got divorced, our love affair went on for 40 years until the day Judy died. Life with Judy was never dull. I remember how once, in the middle of a wedding reception, she suddenly remembered that she was meant to be taking part in a music competition in Chichester. She was three glasses of wine down by then, but we jumped onto the back of my motorbike. I watched her pull off her helmet and leathers and walk on stage to sing her piece just at the very moment they called her name. Then we hopped back on the bike and went straight back to the reception. Needless to say, she won. Judy loved throwing parties at our home, where musicians, performers and poets would dance, chat and sing until the small